but the top five nationalities will always be, or always have been. It will be the UK. The British market is still important, is very important. Then we have, Benelux, I would say, the Dutch and the Belgians. Then obviously Scandinavians. It's Sweden, number one. And then we've got the Danish and the Norwegians. They split around. Sometimes you have more Danes, sometimes you have more Norwegians. And then you have Eastern Europe. Russia is difficult at the moment. It's not that easy. And another market which we can see is getting stronger and stronger is Poland. I've been with Taylor Woodrow, Taylor Wimpey. Now we're Taylor Wimpey. Before we were Taylor Woodrow. I've been with the company since 1993. So I'm in my, I think it's 28th year. Probably few of people like me are dinosaurs around. Started in sales on site. That's my background, actually. Sales on site in a show home. In those days, we didn't have any mobile phones, we didn't have any faxes, and we hardly had air conditioners in the show homes. It was basically sitting there waiting for the clients to come in, and then we had a couple of booked appointments, and the rest was actually inspection visits. It was all inspection viewing trips, and you picked the clients up and spent 2 or 3 or 4 days with them and tried to sell them something. That was Mallorca. I did Mallorca and Menorca. We had a site in Menorca too. And actually, I already then traveled down to the Costa del Sol because we had a site the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, down in Duquesa. We had a site called Los Castillos on Duquesa Gulf. And we had 90 units there, and that was in the middle of the first crisis, so 91, 92, 93. And when I started, I had to sell the rests off. So I came over a couple of times, and that was the initial start on the Costa del Sol. And my background, I came to Spain. I'm German. I'm half German. I was brought up in Germany. I was born in Germany, brought up in Germany. Never lived in the UK, never went to school in the UK. Went to German school near Hamburg, northern Germany. And why Mallorca? How did I end up here? Well, it's basically parents spending holidays here since the mid-70s and falling in love with the island. But I came here to Mallorca in 1989 after I finished my apprenticeship. The idea was go back, just go for a year sabbatical in those days, a sabbatical and start studying. But I ended up on Mallorca in 1989, and I started working as a windsurfing and sailing instructor.
Wow!
And then somebody came up to me, said interested in selling properties this winter. And that was in 1993. And wow. Well, everything else is history. So I've been in this company. I've been with Taylor Wimpey since then, ever since. Started in sales, then sales manager for the Balearic Islands. Then in 2006, 2007, when we started seeing things are getting difficult. You already could see in 2005, 2006 that things were getting difficult. We decided to go more international because in those days we only worked for the UK market. We had a couple of German sales, but basically was very much UK focused. And then we started to open up places like, well, especially Central Europe, Northern Europe, Scandinavia, Eastern Europe, Russia. That was my job for the period of 4 or 5 years. And then I became sales and marketing director for the whole of Spain in 2012.
Perhaps you could tell me a little bit about Taylor Wimpey.
We're Taylor Wimpey since 2008 back in the UK. Before that was Taylor Woodrow and George Wimpey. We merged in 2008 in the middle of the crisis and became Taylor Wimpey. Before that, Taylor Woodrow was more actually a construction and civil engineering company. And there was a housing arm called Taywood Homes. Once the merger took place between Taylor Woodrow and George Wimpey, the whole business actually was streamlined into a housing business. So today, we're a house builder. In 2008, when the mergers took place, we were a house builder in the UK, in North America, in Gibraltar, and in Spain. Those were basically the four regions. North America was managed by, I think, 2010, 2011. We were building in Florida, in Arizona, Northern Southern California, Canada. We had an operation in Toronto, and still are. If you look today, Taylor Morrison, that's the company that was a spin-off, still exists. And I think it's one of the five largest house builders in the US. In the UK, Taylor Wimpey today we're listed in the FTSE 100. and we build basically middle market segment, starter homes, middle market segment. And we currently have, I would say, roughly about 250 sites under construction. And we build and sell in the region of about 13 to 15,000 homes every year. So size-wise, we're 6,000 employees in the UK. And we operate all around. So starting in the south, going right up to Scotland, nothing in Northern Ireland, but basically Scotland, Central England, Southern England, Wales. And we're one of the big three. The big three is Barratt's, Persimmon, and Taylor Wimpey, you would call the big three in the UK.
I think the relevance of this and why I ask is when you one buys off plan, a large consideration is trust.
Absolutely. We've been in business for, it's now over 100 years. We've been in business over 100 years in the UK, and we've been in business in Spain for over 60 years. So it's somebody you can count on, and I think we deliver what we say.
Any agent that deals with new developments and developers generally, Costa del Sol, will be very aware of you guys and girls. The you got to be careful these days.
Nowadays, yeah, I was just going to say.
This is So, but one of the things that I found super interesting about your projects is that you seem to have resisted all temptations, and there are many temptations to get those prices and add a zero to them. Most of your developments tend to be around the 300K mark.
Yeah.
They're sort of a nice mass market, comfy price spot. It's like a sweet spot on the price. And since this whole situation has occurred over the last year and a half worldwide, the high end of the market, particularly in the Marbella area, has been very strong. The recovery is probably been faster than that of the mass market area. Mm-hmm. And then, so in the middle of all this craziness that's been going on, I mean, you've seen two proper recessions, and then you've seen this, which is a fake recession, isn't it? It's not really a recession. It's just a pause button that's been stuck in the middle of a fairly buoyant market. But tell me a little bit about idea of how you choose who your market is, and this, how you've managed to keep from the temptation of
going
to the big bucks, and particularly now that the land is getting a bit more expensive in the area, and it's a bit harder to come by.
Absolutely. Now, but first of all, I think what everybody always should do is stick with what you know. And we're quite good at the market segment we're in. Why should I go into the market segment where I don't know exactly how it works and I'm not really good at? I could get external help. But I think the knowledge we have within the company, the know-how in all parts, starting off in buying the land, technical departments, sales and marketing departments, after sales, which is the key to everything, let's face it. Happy clients just mean everything. We've always resisted going to... We've had a couple of demands where we had 500,000, 600,000, but I think at the moment we've got one or two properties which are over a million mark, which is down in Sotogrande, which would be first line.
Pier,
Sotogrande Marina, but that's quite unique. We're talking about four properties which are front line to the sea, which are going up now. But that's something very specific. It is difficult to get land anywhere in Spain. It won't get any easier. I mean, land prices are increasing everywhere, and building costs are increasing too. So it will be much more difficult staying in that market segment. Average selling price throughout Spain for us is roughly €450,000. It increases because of the Balearic Islands, where we actually offer smaller properties at higher prices, because land costs is even worse here than it is on the Costa del Sol, the Costa Blanca. But on the Costa del Sol at the moment, roughly our average selling price is probably just under the 400,000 mark. So we're slightly higher, but still, as you quite rightly say, it's the middle market segment. Sales, I wouldn't say stopped in 2020, but they did freeze. Yeah, was earlier on. They did. We had times where we hardly did anything, and then it started kicking off again in summer 2020. But obviously, 2020 is a year to forget, to be quite honest. How will we keep in this market segment? I think you've just to have the contacts. I mean, the advantage we always had, we are known to the land sellers as if we shake hands and we agree on a deal, that we do move forward and there aren't any problems. We can pay. There's enough cash in the bank and we don't have any problems whatsoever financing any of our sites. We actually don't work, and none of our sites in Spain or even the UK has ever been financed. Everything is own cash. We don't work together with any bank in Spain at all, which is, again, sometimes an advantage, sometimes a disadvantage, because obviously sometimes you can take over the developer's mortgage, which sometimes could be attractive, but a lot of clients these days actually find it quite attractive. There's no mortgage in place and you can straightforward. There's just so much cash in the market, which we can feel at the moment, actually. Sales are very buoyant all across, in all regions and all over Spain. We're having an extremely good year.
In the mid-market range, seeing everything's bouncing and everything's flying pretty well
at the moment. Yes, we are. Yeah. Not every site. We always have sites which don't perform as well as others. But that's quite normal. I mean, that's normal. You will, if you've got, at the moment, over 20 sites moving across Spain, and we have 8-9 in the Costa del Sol, we have some which just have better average monthly selling rates than others. That's normal. That's completely normal.
Which leads me to the next question, which is, going back to the high end for a second, the area of, well, all areas of Marbella are doing extremely well, but the area particularly that seems to be the sweet spot at the moment is the area of Nueva Andalucía, just located above Puerto Banús.
Yeah.
And it's almost a day doesn't go by where you don't see another 3, 4, 5+ million villa being sold or brought to market.
Yeah.
In the middle of all this craziness where they're starting to get a little bit worried that they're going to be running out of stock, and you guys come and slap a development of 80+ units in 96 apartments for sale in Nueva Andalucía.
Yep.
Priced around the 300K mark.
We're starting 285, going up. The most expensive penthouses are 770, but the average selling price is 450, 470. Yeah. Well, we bought the land, to be honest. We optioned this land end of 2015. So the license took slightly longer than anticipated, to say the least. It's a good site. We've been on the market for about 2.5-3 weeks now, and we've increased prices twice.
So the feedback, as one would expect, is very strong, I think.
Yeah.
The Scandinavians must be loving it, right? Knowing that Swedes.
It's a bit of everything. It's Swedes. We do have a couple of investors going into. So you have a couple of clients, not big investors, buying one or two. Yeah, that's happened. But obviously, there's no hurry to sell these because there's 96. And as a property developer, the biggest disadvantage we have compared to a estate agent, I only can sell each and every property once. And I have to just make sure that I get the right price.
And you can only sell your own property.
Yeah, exactly. Really? That's the other thing. I've only got what's on offer. There's nothing else. I can't go, okay, I've got another one here. That's not there. I haven't got that advantage. Yeah.
So tell me a little bit more about Marbella Lake.
Well, we will build them in 2 or 3 phases, depending on the sales rhythm. That's another thing we do. I wouldn't slap bang 96 units there. I start with one phase, which in this case is 45 units. And see how the sales rhythm is, and if it's what I anticipate, you probably start speeding the site up slightly. As Taylor Wimpey, just to give you an idea, probably we're slightly different to most of our competitors. Was we need to have the site sold once it's finished. I don't want to carry any stock because obviously we're measured at the end of the day. We may have to make profit on each of you. That's the most important thing, but we're measured very heavily on return on capital employed. So very important for a company which is listed in the FTSE 100 and the stock exchange, you have to move money. I don't need properties hanging around because that's cash I could potentially invest in new land. So I just have to make sure that sites move and that the momentum goes the right way.
So there must be quite a delicate and difficult process of establishing when to release the next phase, how many units to release in it, exactly. And at what price.
Right. And then you have to be careful every week that you sell ground floors, first floors, and penthouses at the same pace. And if you don't do that, you should adjust. You need to adjust the prices, because always people start cherry picking, and if they start cherry picking, you're suddenly without penthouses, you're suddenly without ground floors, or you're suddenly without corner units. So you always have to make sure that you look and analyze. Basically, if you've got a site which is turning well, on a weekly basis, just to make sure that you sell them accordingly.
One of the things that happened last year that was a positive, I suppose, was that we kind of jumped 5 years ahead into the future and a lot of the tech side of the marketing, you know, a lot of the sales process, remote selling in all its various forms, from the sophisticated to the highly unsophisticated, but in its various formats, a way of speeding up what you would call pipeline velocity, getting people from that initial contact to nearer the point of buy-in.
I think all of us had to adapt. We had to adapt within the period of a couple of weeks. Lockdown was, I think, 14th of March. And after that, we just started, shit, what are we going to do now? And well, we had a marketing department, which was quite switched on. We had already a lot in place. A lot was already there. Videos was already there. On-site, we already started working with Matterports. We had the first 3D or virtual show homes we already did 4 or 5 years ago. So there was something there. But obviously, we hardly used it because people still could come and visit show homes. So suddenly you haven't got that tool anymore. People, well, you suddenly are without clients. So you have to try to find a way showing what you have, virtually. So it's videos, WhatsApp, Zoom, FaceTime, Teams, whatever it's called. You used everything and anything. And it's changed dramatically. Not only for us as a property developer, I think for the whole world. The whole world has dramatically changed.
For sure.
We had people buying over the phone. That's happened last year and that happened before too, but very, very few. The research done by the clients was much bigger than ever before. That's without any doubt. But I think the fruits of the seeding we did in 2020, I think we're seeing the results now. Basically what we do, we were filling it up. And we can see the sales coming out now and more than we actually anticipated. On the 1st of January 2021, I wouldn't have expected the amount of sales we've done to date, which is the 28th of July 2021. We're far way over budget.
Fantastic. So that leads me to another area, which is super hot at the moment, and that's Benahavís.
Yeah.
And you have something coming up over there as well in the near future, right?
Well, Benahavís is traditional. Obviously, as you probably know, Los Aqueros was bought by us in 1997. And on Los Aqueros Golf and Country Club, we built all together. It was about 1,200 apartments. And there were about 100 villas built too. So, and then we sold the golf course 3 years ago. I think it was three and a half years ago. So we have experience in the Benahavís area. Then we did Botanic, which is just behind Los Aqueros Golf Club, which were 92 units. We've got one unit remaining. And now we've got the Crest, which is on La Quinta.
It's another very hot area.
Yeah, it's Alboada. So we've got competitors like vis-a-vis Nino and Metrovacesa who are selling off.
You could do a zip line from that one to the Marbella Lake over the motorway, right?
That would be ideal. Yeah, you're right, actually. We've got 14 units there, which we just started. There's a big hole there at the moment. There's only 14 units between 385 and just under 600,000 euros. The nice thing, the sweet thing, it's only 14 units. I prefer small communities, and 14, I think, is a good size. We're all three-bedroom apartments, and they're east, southeast facing, and we're looking to hand them over roughly about 2 years' time. We started selling a couple of weeks back. Sales there aren't as quick as Marbella Lake. There you can see that Nueva Andalucía is still a different ballgame to Benahavís. If we look at the sales rhythms over the last 2-3 weeks, and I just told you that we've increased, or we had to increase prices twice, because you could immediately see that they would overheat if you wouldn't act.
I mean, it would sound like a perfect investment, wouldn't it? For somebody, particularly for, I could see some sort of Scandinavian guy that's buying himself a nice big villa.
Yeah.
And he's going to buy 2 or 3 units to have them there as a either buy to rent or buy to sell.
Absolutely. No, it's a good one. You know probably even better than I do. I've known the Costa del Sol for a long time, but you know the area down there. But Nueva Andalucía, I mean, if you've got a site with 96 or 96 units in Nueva Andalucía today, which is probably the very last plot, and in that price segment, I think you can't really go wrong, to be honest. No. And they're nice. They're not big blocks. It's only ground floor plus two. There's always 6 or 8 units. You haven't got, it's not massive. And I think it's we've done a good job of Pablo Leaf, our architect. He's done a good job, actually, putting everything in. you always look at talk about sustainability as a property developer. That's difficult. We're property developers. We don't really create green stuff. I mean, that's fact. We build and we try to do it as good as possible and try to build it in as good as we can into the nature. And I think he's done a pretty good job there. And I think it's going to be a really, really nice site. It's they're good specifications, they're good size, and they're good holiday lifestyle second or even a first home. So you can use them a little bit of everything.
Interesting. I was talking to a Swedish agent the other day. And he was saying that what he's finding is a lot of the entrepreneurs from Scandinavia that are buying,
yeah,
and I presume elsewhere as well. In this case, we were talking about Scandinavian, because of the shift or the blurring of the lines between primary and secondary residences, which seems to be happening with this whole digital nomad thing, yeah, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah,
what a lot of them are starting to do is they're starting to bring their companies over here too.
Right,
and okay. and the thought being is that they would be almost like a secondary fringe benefit to this in the apartment / townhouse market, whereas perhaps, yeah, the owner buys himself the nice 4 million euro villa and his team buys themselves the apartments.
The apartment. That's a big advantage of the Costa del Sol, man. The Costa del Sol, if we look at all the three areas, Balearic Islands, the Costa Blanca, and the Costa del Sol is, first of all, is more, much more cosmopolitan than the other three locations or the other locations. And it's much more year-round area, especially the Marbella, Nova Andalucía, Benahavís area, or anything between Malaga and, let's say, yeah, Estepona, is much more 12 months than most of the other areas we actually operate in Spain. And it's still this Florida of Europe is still a thing which is still there, and I think it's absolutely right.
One of the things that you just mentioned as a interesting point is the environmental eco aspect of the trend in this. You quite, yeah, rightly said that as a builder, your bricks and mortar is not really, yeah, is, no, not really something that's on your radar necessarily instinctively, but it is, as I understand it, becoming more relevant to buyers,
oh,
particularly,
yeah,
particularly in Northern Europe, from what I gather.
No, absolutely. But, I mean, absolutely. Without any more solar panels, pre-installation for electric cars, lighting, that all the LED lighting, you need to make sure that you've got the latest features in place. And we try to do that as much as possible. We try to be as sustainable as we can. Communal areas, just to make sure that they use as little water as possible. Try to put all Mediterranean plants, which don't need as much water as grass, for instance. But I think one thing which will happen again, I think taxes on properties will be probably in future taxed on how energy efficient they are. I think that will happen. I think it will happen across the EU. In Germany, they're already talking about it. I know that, and it will come. So if you've got a house which is very efficient, energetically efficient, you will be able to pay lower taxes. If you've got something which is 30, 40, 50 years old and hasn't been updated or modernized, they will penalize you. I think that's going to happen. That's what we'll see.
At the moment, in the Costa del Sol, what are your main buyer nationalities have this year? Has it changed versus previous years?
No, it hasn't. No, I think the UK market for us, in the market segment we are, the most important, or the important market, is still the British market. The strongest market is actually Belgium, which is interesting. The Belgian market has actually is one of the few markets which is very, very strong on the Costa del Sol and on the Costa Blanca. And if you look at the size of the country and the amount of population it has, it's quite impressive how well Belgium has performed over the last 4 or 5 years, not only the Costa del Sol, but in the Costa Blanca. The majority is actually Flemish-speaking Belgians.
From
buying.
Northern Belgium, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's the vast majority. Then we have a lot of Dutch. We have a lot of Spanish. We do have a lot of Spanish. Yeah, Spanish market is big for us too. It's actually, at this moment, if we look year to date, it's our second market across Spain. Costa del Sol is our third market, especially areas down in Sotogrande. We have quite a few Spaniards. But now in Marbella Lake, over the last couple of weeks, we had quite a few Spaniards buying there too.
That's amazing. I know plenty of Spanish agents in the Costa del Sol in the Marbella area that struggle, yeah, to sell to Spanish buyers.
Yeah. Now we're doing well on the Costa del Sol. We're doing very well. Well, Sotogrande is quite well. We're doing very well with Spanish buyers on the Costa Blanca. That's again, it has to do with the sites you're selling, with the developments you're selling. There are a couple which are actually orientated a little bit more towards the local market, and there you will see it. Then we have one site on Ibiza, and there we have a lot of Spanish. That's quite popular with the Spanish.
In the Balearics, is it your traditional Germans? Are they top two, top three?
Top one. Mallorca, Mallorca at the moment, we've got 70% of our buyers are German and Mallorca. Which is a problem, because obviously if that market drops, we need to find some other nationality somewhere. But the Germans at the moment are buying, like in Northern Italy, the Germans are buying anything and everything. Price is going up to 15 million euros. It's quite impressive, quite amazing what's happening. But we've sold over the last couple of years, man, if we look at, we sold to over 40 different nationalities. This year so far, we're at 15 nationalities. And I think we'll end up the year with probably 25 different nationalities. Now, you have to say that the top five make up probably about 70% or just over 70% of all the sales. So all the others are, you've got a Ukrainian, then you've got a Bolivian, then you've got somebody from South Africa. So it's very international. But the top five nationalities will always be, or always have been, the UK, the British market is still important, is very important. Then we have Benelux, I would say the Dutch and the Belgians. Then obviously Scandinavians, it's Sweden number one. And then we've got the Danish and the Norwegians. They split around. Sometimes you have more Danes, sometimes you have more Norwegians. And then you have Eastern Europe. Russia is difficult at the moment. It's not that easy. And another market which we can see is getting stronger and stronger is Poland.
I've heard that from quite a few sources.
Yeah. Poland is getting a lot stronger.
Interesting. Any idea why?
At the moment, I think everybody's just, the situation with having money in your bank account is not good at the moment. I mean, in Germany, it's across the line. If you've got money in your bank account, you pay penalty interest all across the line. So don't have money in your bank account. And where do you put it? So it's you invested in the stock market, where you don't know what's happening at the moment, or you invested in fun, you invested in lifestyle, you invested for something you've always dreamt of. And obviously that property in Spain on the Costa del Sol or anywhere else is always something which comes in. And especially after the last 18 months we've lived through, I said, yeah, let's go for it. Do it now. You don't know what's around the corner next year. So enjoy your life. If better than leaving that money on your bank account, just rather spend it. Because then that bank account is not going to do you anything. You've got to pay for it in the worst case scenario.
Yeah, there aren't many investments at the moment that satisfy the additional need that's been created by the last 18 months.
True.
That is fairly liquid.
Yeah.
That will very safe bet in terms of appreciation.
Yeah.
And that you could actually generate an income from it if you wanted to. You know, that sort of flexibility, it can be your primary residence, your secondary residence. You can jump between the two. You can rent it out the rest of the year.
Absolutely.
And that's always been the case, but it seems more relevant now because people are jumping around a bit more.
Yeah, I totally agree. I totally agree, Alfredo.
Cool. Well, thank you very much for your time. It's been enlightening. It's a very rare, I try to find other people that maybe I talked to you before online on YouTube and stuff, and you're hard to get hold of. So I appreciate it.
If you need anything at any time, just give me a call. You've got my mobile number. Drop me a line, give me a call, and whatever you need, I'm happy to help if I can.
Cool.
Thanks a lot, Alfredo. Sure.